What's better than improving habitat and making money while you're doing it? Find out how we're doing it right here on LandBeat.
I can't think of a better scenario as a landowner and thinking of how to develop a property, improve the habitat, increase the hunting, than having someone else do some of the work for you. And that's the situation that we're looking at right behind us. This is you and your brother's family farm.
Yep.
And so you're working to improve that. So kind of talk about the situation that happened right here behind us.
Yeah, so one of the big things when we get into land management is going diversity, diversity, diversity. How can we create diversity? Well, when you look at this area, this neighborhood, it's vast acres of closed canopy hardwoods, an oak hickory forest. Well, how can we diversify a forest? Well, we can change the age structure.
Yep.
Or we can go from a pretty big scale disturbance and go from older growth forest down to young forest. And essentially what we did was we created a clear cut or a seed tree cut, because there's a few scattered trees that we left, and we used the logger to disturb or make a major disturbance and improve what our goal will be, bedding for white-tailed deer.
Yeah, based on the intensity and the value that is on these given acres, you can fragment the forest, change ages, and allow that young regeneration to come back. And if you maintain it with things like prescribed fire at different times of the year, you can keep solid cover here for years and years to come.
That's right.
And have dependable bedding. But essentially, now this is where your work begins, as the logging crew has pretty much finished up this part of the project. So what does the next year or two look like to really create this, the ideal bedding cover that's perpetual and that they can't see it right here yet, but there's a food plot we're staying next to?
I have work to do here now too.
Absolutely, it doesn't
stop. So yeah, it never stops. The work that we'll do to make this even better will be promoting stump sprouts or removing too many stump sprouts.
Sure.
So if we have a lot of hickories, which we do, and we're not necessarily trying to let them go crazy, we're gonna try to manage those with herbicide.
Yep.
We're gonna manage with fire and try to keep it in a very manageable state, keeping the stump sprouts below 4 foot, maybe a little higher, but mostly below 4 foot. We want them within reach of the deer for woody browse and better cover.
Absolutely.
All in the meantime, because we're burning on a more of a 3 to 4 year burn rotation, we're gonna have a lot more herbaceous plants here as well. So we'll have food throughout the summer with the herbaceous plants, as well as food throughout the winter with more of the woody browse, and then that's cover year round.
Absolutely.
It's really hard to beat the standpoint of we received money from the logger because of all the lumber they pulled out of here, but then we also got a really awesome bedding area that creates a diversified forest that now we can define bedding and also help the whole ecosystem for many other wildlife species.
Certainly, certainly. This is not just gonna benefit deer. We know that turkeys can nest in here. We know that if this was an area where rough grouse were present, they would be utilizing this, and it hits a lot of different life cycles for their yearly needs. So there's a lot of benefit that you can achieve by having a logging crew come in responsibly log, but if you're working with them closely and define these areas, essentially this work, the implementation part was done on their behalf. Now your behalf as a landowner is to maintain and keep it in this awesome state that we know is gonna concentrate deer during daylight and allow some phenomenal memories to be made right here, probably where we're standing or very close proximity in the years to come.
That's right. Now let's go look at it in more detail.
Perfect.
So one of the things, when you compare what it would look like if we cut it, you and I, versus the logger cutting it, and now in the comparison of the two, since the logger cut it, essentially he cut the trunks and drug them out of here.
Yep.
If we had cut it, we would basically be cutting trees to leave lay.
Right.
As you can see back behind us, there's a few treetops that would make it difficult for the deer to navigate, but there's some skitter trails the deer can easily walk down. So when you're looking at it from a standpoint of me, the landowner, cutting it versus the logger, it's much more, there's more usable space, more places that a deer could bed down and navigate through, because the tree, the basal area or trees per acre, is very dense here. If right. we had just cut them, it would have been a mess.
You create this game of almost pickup sticks.
Yep.
If you have so much debris laying across it, and that will interfere with the way deer move in yeah. and around it. The interior wouldn't get much use. The edges would,
yep.
but really we want the entire acreage of a cut to be designed and work as it should. Mm-hmm. And you have to take some of that debris out. So having that crew that yep. knew there was marketable value in this acreage could take the, I would say 50, 60% of what debris was cut, get it out of there,
That's
make
right.
money, and now the navigation and usability from deer is gonna be way more increased 3-4 years down the road.
Absolutely, and one of the things when you look at this and the layout of the terrain, if you look at it on a topo map overlay, yep. you can see that this little kind of point of a ridge, it's a long ridge, but then there's a saddle at the end of it. So this is a great little spot that deer have bedded just because of the terrain.
Certainly.
But now that we have better cover, better vegetation down within a deer's level, it makes it, it took a mediocre bedding area,
right.
and then the next step would be a good bedding area, and then as this grows up in a few years, it's gonna be a great bedding area.
Absolutely. Sometimes it takes time to make wine, and that's yeah. the situation. We're seeing the front end of, okay, this was just done, but the vision is still here with all these other components. Food plot, point, saddle, great access to be able to hunt this location. It's gonna be lights out once the vegetation responds, but it's got enough sunlight to do so
yep.
and space for deer to work and come in and around here. And by looking around to some of the other plant species that are coming back in the other logged areas, the response is gonna be phenomenal.
It'll
lots of food, lots of cover, can't
and
wait.
And you mentioned it, we haven't even talked about it yet, but there's a nice almost 2-acre food plot just north of this.
Yeah.
That it sets up perfectly for shrinking that gap that a lot of landowners face from going to bed, a deer bedding, and getting to food before dark, or
Absolutely.
Going from food to bedding before daylight. And so they feel much more comfortable going into this food plot because it's right here next to dense cover.
Cover is adjacent, great quality food.
Yeah.
Let's go check it out.
Yeah.
There's the food plot there.
We're just a few feet away, you know, 20 yards from where we were last at. And then we've got a food plot that has soybeans in it right now to try to control some of those weeds.
Sure.
But ultimately, we're going to have a diversified food source with brassicas and clovers and then
right.
annuals in the fall. Right here, I mean, just a few feet away from what's the beginning of a really nice cut. And I think that's the big thing. A lot of times landowners, when they get into a logging operation or the idea is, there's the kind of the fear factor.
Absolutely.
This is scary to a lot of people.
This is
But
shocking.
You have to look past the major disturbance to see that we're creating a very healthy, diversified forest. We're creating a landscape that's very conducive to meeting a lot of wildlife needs.
Without doubt.
Game and non-game species. And all tying it together from a hunting standpoint is we've created really good bedding close to a really nice food plot.
Absolutely. I think what we commonly see with landowners is one of two things. They're very fearful to take the step of having a logging operation because
That's right.
they're scared of the change.
Yep.
I understand that. But things aren't going to get better unless you change. Things
Yep.
will probably go downhill in value for wildlife. But then two is maybe they take the step of doing the change, but then there's no follow-up work like we've talked about. There's still responsibility on your end to maintain and create better cover here, but what we see is landowners, they take that step, they do the logging, but then they don't follow up and keep it
That's
going
right.
for long term, and so they kind of shortchange themselves, whether they don't take step number one or they don't follow through, but
yep.
it's a multi-step process, and right now it looks scary, it looks ugly, but vision-wise, we know what's going to happen.
Yeah.
We know how wildlife are going to respond. And again, we've got proximity, spatial distribution of deer right here bedded, feeling comfortable, and then feeding right here, feeling comfortable.
Yeah.
Who doesn't want to hunt that?
So when it comes into having a log or a timber operation come into your farm, one of the big things to look at is just try to think big picture. Think years down the road, not the weeks to follow, the months
right.
to follow. Think big picture. There's the shock effect with the timber harvest, but you also make the financial gains, hopefully, in
that
your pilot
you
that you can reinvest
absolutely.
Into the farm or help pay for the farm. In this case, where that's one of the ways we're helping pay for the farm.
Yes.
I think about it from this standpoint. If I was out of shape
yeah.
and I wanted to get back into shape, the sore muscle period is my least favorite part of working out. And I work out all the time, as you can tell.
Sure.
And the sore muscles is a problem. Like, that's a phase that most of us don't like. And we're in the sore muscle phase. We don't like it.
Yeah.
It's kind of, but we know when getting through the sore muscle phase, the phase that we're in here on the farm, it's going to be a much healthier landscape.
The end goal is super clear in a weight loss program, right? We all know what we want to look like. Well, we know vision-wise what this is going to look like. We just got to get there.
That's right.